10 o'clock.
News this hour from townhall.com. I'm Michael Harrington. Police in California have picked up a man they believe killed six men and wounded a woman over the past several months in a series of shootings. 43-year-old Wesley Brownlee of Stockton stopped in a car about 2 a.m. yesterday. Police say he was dressed in black, had a gun, and appeared to be, quote, out hunting for another victim. They've been searching for somebody to fit that description since July. The targeted killings of police, meanwhile, in this country are on the rise.
Organizations that track violence against police say 56 officers have been killed by gunfire so far this year. That number is up 14% from this time last year and about 45% from October of 2020. The country is on track to approach or surpass other top annual totals of recent years, including 73 officers killed in 2011 and 67 killed in 2016. I'm Shelley Adler.
The U.S. and Canada are delivering armored vehicles to Haiti.
The equipment was bought by Haiti's government and flown in Saturday on U.S. and Royal Canadian Air Force aircraft to the capital of Port-au-Prince to help police fight a powerful gang. The equipment arrived more than a month after one of Haiti's most powerful gangs surrounded a fuel terminal and demanded the resignation of Prime Minister Ariel Henry. Demonstrators also have blocked roads in major cities to protest a sharp rise in fuel prices. After Henry announced in early September his administration could no longer afford to subsidize fuel. Rhonda Rockstra reporting.
For months, Elon Musk, the Tesla and SpaceX CEO, has expressed interest in creating his own version of China's WeChat, a super app that does video chats, messaging, streaming, payments for the rest of the world. He says his acquisition of Twitter will speed things along. More on these stories at townhall.com.
These are tough times for everyone, so dealing with your timeshare may not be your biggest concern. But when this passes, do you still want a lifetime of payments, fees, and commitments for a timeshare you were misled into buying?
Hi, I'm Chuck McDowell, CEO and founder of Wesley Financial Group. 10 years ago, I started the timeshare cancellation industry by exposing the ugly truth about timeshares and giving folks the straight facts. I've been fighting the timeshare giants ever since, so no one knows this industry better than me and my team. Today, we have saved our clients an average of $65,000 in lifetime payments. Imagine putting those timeshare dollars back in your pocket. Give my office a call today. I guarantee if we take you as a client, we will cancel your timeshare or you'll pay nothing.
Call Wesley Financial now for your free information kit. 800-549-8866. That's 800-549-8866. 800-549-8866. Wesley Financial Group is not a law firm.
Workers at an Apple store in Oklahoma City have voted to unionize, marking the second unionized Apple store in the U.S. in a matter of just a few months.
According to an initial tally by the National Labor Relations Board, 56 workers at the store located in Oklahoma City's Penn Square Mall voted to be represented by the Communications Workers of America. 32 were opposed. The vote on Friday signaled another win for the labor movement. It's been gaining momentum since the pandemic. If no objections are filed, the results will be certified, and the employer must begin bargaining in good faith with the union. Bob Agner reporting.
After a COVID-19 hiatus, the first global robotics challenge for high school students is taking place in person again, with teams from almost every country in the world, though not Russia this year. The event is on the theme of carbon capture. Trouble for the Ukrainian squad to get there. They had to scramble to find a way over in time. News and analysis at townhall.com. One top public health official says Africa must plan to respond effectively to disease outbreaks without help from the outside.
Ahmed Ogwell, acting head of the Africa Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, warned that the continent of 1.3 billion people is, quote, on its own during pandemics. Ogwell said that as assistance often never materializes, African nations must plug gaps to respond to outbreaks such as Ebola in Uganda. Uganda declared an outbreak of Ebola on September 20th.
Correspondent Jeremy House. Today is Sunday, October the 16th, and some notable people are celebrating a birthday today, including sportscaster Tim McCarver. He is 81 years old. Actress Suzanne Somers turns 76 today. Singer John Mayer has 45 candles on his birthday cake. U.S. Olympic and retired WNBA basketball star Sue Bird is 41. More on these stories at townhall.com.
This Atmos weather report is being brought to you by Summit Technology Group. Summit Technology Group provides advanced technical solutions to the ever-evolving broadcast industry. More information is available online at summittechgroup.com.
Your area conditions, currently 36 degrees in Rome. Here is your WKAL 1450 AM, 103.3 FM Utica Rome Metro weather forecast for Sunday, the 16th day of October. I'm meteorologist Charles Dixon. Clear in Rome, and good morning to listeners in Oneida, where it is currently clear and 39 degrees. Getting down to 36 overnight tonight. Monday's high will be in the high 50s. Brief afternoon showers. Temperatures in the high 40s on Tuesday. A couple of afternoon showers, a morning shower or two. I'm meteorologist Charles Dixon on 1450 AM 103.3 FM. WKAL, more stimulating talk radio.
This is Coach Big C, and you're listening to the Mohawk Valley Sports Watch on WKAL 1450.
You know, I think Cody gets everybody fired up in here in the morning.
He's a troll.
He's a troll.
Mute button. Where's his mute button?
He's a troll. He just says whatever he can to incite the riot to happen here.
My ears are bleeding.
All I said was in 4 years, the top four quarterbacks in the NFL are going to be...
Hold on. I want you to say this on the air so we can...
We can justfully ridicule it, yes.
We'll have it on tape.
Mark it down now. I'll say 5 years.
Oh, now he's changing
it. 5 years. Okay. The best four quarterbacks in the NFL, Mahomes 1, Allen 2, Herbert 3, DeMore at 4.
It's hard to knock him. It's a 4 to me.
And that will be the last time he touches the microphone today.
All right, let's go back to little Syracuse here.
Doormat, more like.
Okay.
Okay, thanks.
Right. Yeah, mumbling.
It's tough to be a troll. You got to practice.
You do.
Well, Jake's going to be calling in here a little bit, but let's cut him off
because he's going to talk Clemson. So we don't want that this week.
So as I was saying before we got to the 10 o'clock hour, I realistically went through the schedule again, and I said, I think they will beat Notre Dame. I think they will beat Boston College. I think they will beat Pitt. Wake, I still don't know yet, but the way Syracuse's defense is playing, they could. And I know everybody's going to chalk up next week at Clemson because of just Clemson at home. But I think that game's going to be a better game than people think.
Me too.
I think they have a chance to beat Clemson.
Well, and I think a couple weeks ago we talked about how Syracuse in the past, when they struggled, the one team they played close for whatever reason was always Clemson. Yeah. The last two got out of hand late, but the first half was even close, even on the games they were getting blown out. So I think it's one of those things where Dino gets them fired up for that Clemson game. Again, you know, it's one thing to go in with nothing to lose, expectations, you know, we're not going to win this game, blah, blah, blah. People are starting to pick Syracuse. Mm-hmm. They're going to be favored in games. It's different to be the favored team as well.
I mean, when you're undefeated, you believe in yourself. So I think that gives you more of a chance to go in than Clemson and pick up a victory.
You know, one thing I can honestly say, though, because we were watching, my wife and I stopped at the recovery room last night on the way home, and it was packed with Syracuse people.
From where?
We went to Creekside Inn there to eat dinner last night.
I thought you were going to say you were at the casino and popped over.
No, we were there a couple weeks ago. But anyways, one thing I can honestly say is when you watch Dino Baber this year so far, man, he looks relieved.
Well, I mean, I still think he mismanaged the end of the first half. I mean, it's second down. You have timeouts to go. They run a run play up the middle with a minute and 40 seconds left. You've absolutely dominated the first half, and you got a shot. I mean, you've thrown two
interceptions, one in the end zone and one in the 10-yard line, and you get a shot to get the ball back. Your offense has got 300 yards of offense, and he holds on to his timeouts. I mean, those are the little things that, right. again, you're gonna be NC State with their backup quarterback, but that game should have been 41-10 or something like that. And there's your message set that we can play. You know, you win the game 24-9.
But he just looks really relieved that he's not coaching for his job right now.
He does, but he also still looks clueless at times. Mm. Like, Robert and I's done a really good job with the offense. Tony White, Swag Daddy, awesome job with the defense.
And I think
this is Dino away from everything.
Yeah, I think
just let him stand there, look cool, and say some inspirational things in every coach's interview and move on.
And that's something we haven't really talked about. We always joke about, you know, the Dino talk and when he gets fired. But, like, these two guys have come into Syracuse, and I think that's why Syracuse is where they are today. Not because Dino Babers woke up in the morning and all of a sudden figured out how to coach this team.
But I will say this. Part of being a head coach is finding the right people to hire. So, again, just because struggled and, you know, he's calling his own plays and doing this, I think he's got the right offensive coordinator.
Agreed.
He brought in a great quarterbacks coach with the offensive coordinator in Beck.
Mm-hmm.
He's got a great defensive coordinator. Now it's just bringing in more people and making it, again, an expectation that you can compete in the ACC.
Well, and I think as a head coach at that level, if the head coach is doing a lot of coaching, I think it's a problem.
Yes.
I think at that level, I think your coordinator should coach the game, and your head coach just manages the game. Now, the fourth down calls I get at the end of the halves and the end of the game, that's on the head coach.
Right.
To go, and I think that's one of the big transitions with Jim Harbaugh over the years is Jim called the plays.
Yeah.
You know, for a lot of years. And Jim turned it over. I mean, Josh Gattis came in from Penn State, and now he brings in another offense and defense. I still don't like the co-offensive coordinator stuff.
Yeah.
But I think the only thing that scares me about Syracuse is that they get deep into this schedule. Can they score 30, 40 points a game and play? If Clemson's 30, 40 points a game, the Syracuse have the offensive firepower to score 30, 40 a game. I know defensively they're really good.
I'm going to say this. For Syracuse to win games down the stretch, they cannot be the most penalized team in the country. Because right now they are the most penalized team in the country, and it almost bit them in the foot again yesterday.
But are they going to beat a Clemson 20-something to 15? Are they going to beat Wake 20-something?
I think they can beat somebody that way. Mm-hmm. Their defense has, but again, injuries are starting to pile up. You got to see what happens with Garrett Williams. There's linebackers out. I mean, they've gotten beaten up pretty good all year, and they've been good about guys stepping up and playing well. I don't know. I don't know if they can win a game. I don't know if they can outscore Clemson 41-37. I don't know if they can outscore Wake 42-38 and beat them. I think their defense has got to keep it under 30, I would say. You know, under 30,
yeah.
And they win a game 27-24.
So for the Syracuse faithful as you guys, bowl game for the first time in what?
4 years.
Four years. Regardless of what happens the rest of the way. Are you guys happy with going to a bowl game this year? Has it been a successful season?
It's been an improvement. I still don't call it a successful season because you got to finish the season. Mm-hmm. And as a Syracuse fan, I remember the 4-0 and 3-0 starts and then 3-9 finishes. So I think at this point, I mean, we can talk records and whatnot. You know, 8-4 season, we'd take it in a heartbeat. Sure. But at the same time, we'd also be saying that means they went 2-4 down the stretch. And to me, I would not be happy with that. I think at this point you got to look at the schedule and say pull up the schedule and say what's acceptable, you know, down the stretch.
Well, with six games left, I think again Notre Dame's struggling. That's at home. That might be a winnable game. I would say win for Syracuse against Notre Dame.
But if
I still don't think they beat Clemson.
Stop.
7-1.
Okay, so I still think it's good. I think they go to Pitt and beat Pitt.
Yep.
I think they beat Florida State at home.
9-1.
Not giving them a win at Wake.
9-2.
And they beat Boston College.
10-2.
That's what I'm saying. 10-2 would be a great season. Yep. Now, if they finish 8-4, and we go and they go 2-4 down the stretch, wouldn't you be disappointed with how they finished?
I would.
Yeah, I think I would.
It depends on the losses coming against them.
And that stinks because you look at the schedule in the beginning and you say 8-4 with Syracuse coming off all these 3-4 wins. 8-4. I mean, you laughed at me when I said 8-4 and 9-3 in the beginning of the year. Now we're saying 8-4 would be
a disappointment.
A disappointment down the stretch.
Yeah. Because you see the teams not like that are left. I mean, if they lose against Clemson and Notre Dame and I don't know who else you mentioned, but
Wake, Florida State.
But I mean, if they lose games down the stretch to teams that they should win. I would be more disappointed with that.
These were all games going into
and how they lose too.
These were all games going into the season that we said they could win. These were all 50-50 games. Now we're leading on the, you know, positive side of it. Where in the past it's Syracuse will struggle, they'll be close and they'll find a way to lose. Now we're saying we expect them to win. These are still 50-50 games.
Yeah, but because you're seeing the type of teams. We didn't know what Notre Dame was before. We didn't know Notre Dame was going to be this bad.
And
we didn't know what Syracuse was going to be either by that same token.
So my question is Syracuse good or is their schedule just
very bad?
Weaker than we thought.
I think Syracuse is better, but the competition that they're playing is not what it was before, so they're able to win these games now.
Put Syracuse in the SEC and the Big Ten, and where do they finish? That's the thing. If you want to call Syracuse good, and again, I'm a Syracuse fan.
I don't think they finish.
Where do they finish in the Big Ten? In the Pac-12, they might win it.
All right, hold on a minute.
All right, they might win it because the Pac-12 is terrible.
The SEC. So the SEC East, they're not better than Georgia.
No.
They're not better than Tennessee.
No.
Kentucky's in third place in the East.
I would say
comparable.
Maybe third or fourth. Yeah. I would say they're right on par, maybe a little better, maybe a little worse, depending on the day, than Kentucky. Yeah. So they're the third best team in that division.
And you got South Carolina and Florida right there. I mean,
I think they're better than both of them right now.
So then go to the West. I don't think they're better than Ole Miss. I don't think they're better than Alabama. I don't think they're better than LSU, who's 4-1. I don't think they're better than Mississippi State. Talent-wise, I don't think they're better than A&M, but I think record-wise they are. So maybe the West are in the middle of the pack of the West.
Mm-hmm. So what would that be, fifth or sixth?
Fifth or sixth
so
in the West.
So they'd be what, the at best ninth best team, eighth best team in the SEC?
Now, if you go to the Big Ten, I'll just say let's go with the Big Ten East. They're not better. Well, I know you're going to say Michigan, but I don't think they're better than Michigan or Ohio State. I don't know about Penn State. We'll see how they fare the rest of the way. Maryland's got a load of talent. I would say they're probably 4 or 5 in the Big Ten East. Put them in the West. I think they can win the West.
Yeah. Agreed. I would say one thing going down the stretch, I mean, if for the offense to succeed, I mean, they've got to have more from the wide receivers than just Aronde Gadsden. I mean, you're going to be able to bracket him. He's not going to always be able to get wide open or even get open, especially against teams like Clemson. Who've got more athleticism in the back end. So, I mean, it's going to be interesting to see if you can get Sherrod Johnson involved, if you can get, you know, Alford involved more, and maybe even get some tight end production. I mean, if you give him more to worry about in the passing game than just Gadsden, that's going to be the key to the success, I think.
I think the whole key for Syracuse late in the season is going to be can they get pressure up front with that front four? Because the back half is as good as anybody's. The linebacking crew and secondary is playing really well. A lot of speed back there. And I said this with Michigan when they play Ohio State is they beat Ohio State last year because they got pressure on C.J. Stroud from the outside and the inside.
And didn't have to bring extra pressure
in. And they didn't have to do a lot of things on the back end because he was running for his life. If you give Sam Hartman time to throw the ball, any quarterback in college to throw the ball, they're going to pick you apart regardless. So, to me, the second half of the season is going to be, can Syracuse's defense get pressure with the front four? I think will be the key. I think offensively it's going to be – Syracuse ain't going to get away from what they've been doing offensively. That's just who they are. I don't think Syracuse is a team that's going to be a 40-50-point offense. I think it's 20-30 and play defense.
Mm-hmm.
I could be wrong, but I think that's about where they are, and there's nothing wrong with that. You can win games that way. But I just don't see them winning a 55-52 game if they have to.
I think, you know, I'm going to agree with what you said, but I'm also going to add to it. I think Sean Tucker needs to be more than an 80-yard-a-game guy for Syracuse to win games down the stretch.
Yeah.
I think, again, you got to be creative in finding ways to get him the ball, whether it's on screens, on dump-off passes, line him up as a receiver. He's got to get more than 14 touches a game. I think he had 14 rushes for 80 yards, and 30 of them was on the last play, and 25 of them was on his first carry of the game. So I think they got to be a little more creative and get him. Granted, he's a little banged up right now, but you got to find ways for him to be more involved. And again, you know, you're talking about a guy that had Heisman hopes going in, who's, you know, he's been a solid running back. I think they had him in the draft thing as like the sixth best running back in the country, but he's not putting up sixth best running back stats right now.
Well, I think the other key is too is when you look at the offense, you look at Schrader. I just pulled up his numbers. He's completing just under 70% of his balls with, and if you can have a quarterback that's completing 70% of your passes,
yeah,
you're putting your team in contention to win games. And the other thing is too, 12 touchdowns, only 3 interceptions.
And 2 were yesterday.
Yeah. So he hasn't really turned the ball over, which is always good from your quarterback.
Yep.
You know,
to think about what Schrader was last year, I think there might have been something with an injury that they didn't talk about that might have hampered him a little bit, but he is like a different quarterback. It's like night and day difference of how well he's throwing the ball this year as opposed to last year.
But he has been sacked 13 times.
And a lot of those are because he's holding the ball too long or he starts scrambling around a little bit too early.
Mm-hmm.
So you got to remember, 2 years ago, he was a wide receiver at Mississippi State.
Yeah.
So, I mean, the transition from quarterback to wide receiver and then back to quarterback, you know,
Is he a senior? This is last year, right?
No, I think he's got one more. Yeah.
Does he stay another year?
I don't know. He's not a draft prospect. I could see him staying another year and then transitioning in the NFL to be like a
Taysom Hill type. Does Del Rio stay if Schrader stays?
Would think so because it's his job after.
Yeah.
I mean, I say that they have.
He's basically the heir apparent.
Well, you got Sellers that's a highly recruited guy that was going to go to Virginia that's following Anai and Beck over, and he's supposed to be a stud.
Mm.
So I don't know. I don't know where the offense is in 2 years. I don't know. If how long Anai stays, I don't know what happened. I mean, who knows? But I think right now Schrader's your guy as long as he wants to be there. And, you know, I think you're comfortable as a Syracuse fan knowing that your backup could be the starter in a lot of other places.
Yeah.
Well, next week there's some big games in college football again, highlighted by the noon kick, Syracuse and Clemson. And, I mean, I know game day's going to UCLA and in Oregon, but man, I'll tell you, 2-1 beatings in the ACC. That's a tough game not to go to.
Right.
Yeah.
With huge, huge implications in the ACC. Iowa's going to go at Ohio State. Iowa can't seem to find a way to score touchdowns. It's a tough defense. We'll see what Ohio State can do. I think Ohio State rolls.
Yep.
Tennessee will be at home to UT Martin. Kansas and Baylor. And I know we talked about Baylor last week, but another loss for Baylor. Dave Aranda, who was that hot coach. Baylor's at 500. Cincinnati, who's going to make that transition to the Big 12, still playing well. They'll play at SMU. How about another big game for Oklahoma State coming off that loss to TCU? Now they play home to Texas. Mm-hmm. So that should be a big game. That's on ABC. Ole Miss and LSU, they'll go play at Tiger Stadium. That'll be a good game. UCLA, Oregon, that'll probably be one of the primetime games. That's at 3:30. Boston College and Wake Forest, Marshall against James Madison. Mississippi State at Alabama. We'll see if Alabama bounces back. Penn State's going to get the whiteout game. I missed it by a week. It's the whiteout game at home to Minnesota. And then the 8 o'clock game, which should be another good game, Kansas State, TCU. That'll be the 8 o'clock game.
It's Saturday lineup.
Game I should pick be, TCU and they'd lose.
Should be a really, really good matchup.
They do that all the time.
All right, well, we're going to take a break. When we come back, we'll switch gears. We'll talk some Buffalo Bills, Kansas City. And is that for home field in the playoffs, or is it too soon, too early in the season to start thinking home playoff? Who's got home field advantage? We'll see. It's a big game in the NFL. The Giants play today as well against Baltimore. We'll see what the Giants can do. I say this as Giants fans as I am. We're the worst 4-1 team in the league, but the best thing about it is
still 4-1.
We're 4-1 atop the NFC East. So stay tuned. We'll be right back.
Hi, I'm Avina. I'm 7 years old and I'm blind. I love gymnastics, piano, public speaking, and riding on the trail bike with my dad. You can help me live the life I want.
Help Ravina and other blind people by making a tax-deductible donation of your used car, truck, or almost anything with wheels to the National Federation of the Blind. Your donation will ensure a brighter future for blind children and adults. Just call 866-282-7327. That's 866-282-7327. Or visit carshelpingtheblind.com. That's carshelpingtheblind.com. We will arrange to have the donated vehicle picked up and provide you with a tax-deductible receipt. And if you know someone who is blind that can use our help, email nfb@nfb.org.
Blindness does not hold me back at all. Donate today.
All right, guys, we're ready for our four-season sunroom, and Daddy's gonna get a rec room with refreshments.
Oh, no, we'll be sleeping under the stars.
Mom, what about the one with, you know, the fun?
Nice try, little bro. It's a gym. My gym.
Hey, Grandma's getting her Four Seasons garden room, weather tight and still like being outdoors.
Maybe a living room. Oh, no, wait, a family hub.
Yeah!
No matter what the budget, the season, or the climate, Four Seasons Sunrooms let you and your family enjoy the outdoors inside. Call now to hear more about these great offers from the premier manufacturer of sunrooms since 1975.
More reasons for Four Seasons now.
To find out more, call toll-free 800-848-6333. That's 800-848-6333.
Can you remember the last time you tried something out without searching for it online first? Me either. Yet, over half of all small businesses don't even have a website. Why is that? It's so easy. Thayer2Design will work with your business to create an affordable, customizable, and easy-to-use website that appears in today's top search engines. That way, consumers can find you. Don't let your business get lost in cyberspace. Visit Thayer2Design.com and tell them WKAL sent you. THAYER, the number 2, design.com.
Hey, everybody, this is the coach from the Mohawk Valley Sports Watch. Join myself, Pete Pagsman Pagliaro, the coach Nick Medesis, and the stat man Eric Coleman on our new day as we move to Sundays from 9 to 11 on WKAL Talk Radio, 1450 and 103.3 FM.
You can listen to WKAL on almost any device imaginable. Our website, WKAL1450.com, and our Facebook page, WKAL1450, has all the information. And now you can listen to us on your Alexa device.
Alexa, tune in WKAL.
WKAL from TuneIn.
WKAL is everywhere, around the region at 1450 AM and around the world on your Alexa device and WKAL1450.com.
All right, guys, we're ready for our four-season sunroom, and Daddy's gonna get a rec room with refreshments.
Oh, no, we'll be sleeping under the stars.
Mom, what about the one with, you know, the fun?
Nice try, little bro. It's a gym. My gym. Hey, Grandma's getting her Four Seasons garden room, weather tight and still like being outdoors.
Maybe a living room. Oh, no, wait, a family hub.
Yeah!
No matter what the budget, the season, or the climate, Four Seasons Sunrooms let you and your family enjoy the outdoors inside. Call now to hear more about these great offers from the premier manufacturer of sunrooms since 1975.
More reasons for Four Seasons now.
To find out more, call toll-free 800-848-6333. That's 800-848-6333.
And right here we're talking with Zorro, and we're discussing the way to the Best Buy in today's AM radio receivers. The mark of...
Zorro!
No, that's AMAX. When buying your AM radio receiver, always look for AMAX.
Zorro takes a backseat to no one. Defender of the downtrodden, the uptrodden. Look, here's the mark of Zorro there.
Okay.
Sorry.
It's okay. Folks, look for the AMAX mark for modern, better quality in your AM radio.
Perhaps Mamacita could sew it like new.
It's okay.
Be all right.
AMAX.
Talk Radio 1450.
With SRN News, I'm Michael Harrington in Washington. Chinese leader Xi Jinping speaking at a Communist Party gathering today. He is calling for faster military development and says there'll be no changes in policies that have strained relations with Washington. He's also tightening the rule that the Communist Party has over Chinese society and the economy. The country's most influential figure in decades speaking at the start of a long party meeting. Watch closely, his comments were by companies and governments around the world as well as the Chinese people themselves. Iranian media say a towering blaze at a notorious prison housing political prisoners and anti-government activists in Iran's capital has killed four inmates, but there were no escapes. And after a COVID-19 hiatus, the first global robotics challenge for high school students is taking place in Geneva, Switzerland this week. This is SRN News.
These are tough times for everyone, so dealing with your timeshare may not be your biggest concern. But when this passes, do you still want a lifetime of payments, fees, and commitments for a timeshare you were misled into buying?
Hi, I'm Chuck McDowell, CEO and founder of Wesley Financial Group. 10 years ago, I started the timeshare cancellation industry by exposing the ugly truth about timeshares and giving folks the straight facts. I've been fighting the timeshare giants ever since, so no one knows this industry better than me and my team. Today, we have saved our clients an average of $65,000 in lifetime payments. Imagine putting those timeshare dollars back in your pocket. Give my office a call today. I guarantee if we take you as a client, we will cancel your timeshare or you'll pay nothing.
Call Wesley Financial now for your free information kit. 800-549-8866. That's 800-549-8866. 800-549-8866. Wesley Financial Group is not a law firm.
The current temperature, 43 degrees.
With SRN Sports, I'm Ron DeRockster. Jake Cronenworth hit a tie-breaking two-run single with two outs in the seventh, and the Padres rally past the Dodgers 5-3 to advance to the NL Championship Series for the first time since 1998. Padres stunned the 111-win Dodgers with the five-run rally to win the best-of-five division series 3-1 at Petco Park in front of the home crowd. San Diego will host Philadelphia in games 1 and 2 of the NLCS on Tuesday and Wednesday nights after the Phillies beat the Braves 8-3. Astros get a home run from Jeremy Peña in the top of the 18th inning, hold serve to beat the Mariners 1-0 and advance to the AL Championship Series for the sixth straight year. Next up will be either the Yankees or the Guardians in game 1 on Wednesday, but the Bombers are on the brink of elimination after their bullpen failed in the 9th inning, giving up 4 runs, losing to Cleveland 6-5, and now Cleveland has a 2-1 advantage. SRN Sports. College football Saturday featured 6 games matching ranked teams, including 3 battles of unbeatens, and promises to set the tone for the second half and sort the contenders from the pretenders. Number 5 Michigan stepped forward emphatically in the Big Ten with a 41-17 thrashing of 10th-ranked Penn State. Number 13, TCU made an improbable rally to beat 8th-ranked Oklahoma 43-40 in 2 overtimes to become the Big 12 favorite. And 6th-ranked Tennessee put the Southeastern Conference on a tilt with a last-second field goal to beat 3rd-ranked Alabama for the first time in 15 meetings, 52-49. Other notables, 18th-ranked Syracuse starts 6-0 for the first time since 1939 with a 24-9 win over 15th-ranked NC State. And Oklahoma's 18th straight win over the Jayhawks, 52-42. Dates back to 1997. This is SRN Sports.
This Atmos weather report is being brought to you by Summit Technology Group. Summit Technology Group provides advanced technical solutions to the ever-evolving broadcast industry. More information is available online at summittechgroup.com.
Your area conditions, currently 36 degrees in Rome. Here is your WKAL 1450 AM, 103.3 FM Utica Rome Metro weather forecast for Sunday the 16th day of October. I'm meteorologist Charles Dixon. Clear in Rome and good morning to listeners in Oneida, where it is currently clear and 39 degrees. Getting down to 36 overnight tonight, Monday's high will be in the high 50s, brief afternoon showers. Temperatures in the high 40s on Tuesday. A couple of afternoon showers, a morning shower or two. I'm meteorologist Charles Dixon on 1450 AM 103.3 FM. WKAL, more stimulating talk radio.
This is Coach Big C, and you're listening to the Mohawk Valley Sports Watch on WKAL 1450.
That one's for Cody in here to play the Oregon fight song for him.
Maybe that'll calm him down.
Yeah. Hey, but I just told him, Oregon's got it in their hands. They just got to continue to win and silence the doubters and see what happens at the end of the year if they're a one-loss Pac-12
maybe,
champion.
Maybe. Maybe.
Never know.
Can't get any worse than losing by 46 game one, but.
Hey, listen, my wife was in her glory because the 1 year Oregon played Ohio State, she's from Oregon, so she was kind of a winner either way.
Right.
But I thought she would have been pulling for Oregon.
No.
No, never.
She was pulling for Ohio State that game.
Of course.
All right,
wouldn't she?
All right, well, let's talk about a little NFL today. The game of the day is at 4:25 on CBS. Bills-Chiefs. This one's at Arrowhead. The Chiefs are...
For the fifth straight time.
Buffalo's a 2.5-point favorite in that one. And I'll ask you guys the question is, I know it's early in the season. We're only in game six. But I was saying to some Buffalo fans yesterday at my daughter's soccer, I said, if Kansas City gets home field advantage, I think it's going to be tough to beat Mahomes in Kansas City. If Buffalo gets home field, I think it's going to be tough to beat Josh Allen and the Bills. Now, a coin toss away, Buffalo's in the Super Bowl. Does this game have any playoff implication, or is it too early?
It's way too early. I mean, if you remember last year, Buffalo went into Kansas City, went into Arrowhead, and beat them up in the regular season pretty good. And you can see that game meant nothing come playoff time. You know, I think it goes back to, you know, a loss to Jacksonville and a loss at Tennessee when the quarterback tripped. And again, like you said, home field advantage, maybe it's different, maybe it's not. But, you know, at the end of the day, it's week six. It's a good game to win. It's a good game to for the fans because this is two of the better teams in the league. But in the big picture, I mean, it's just another game to get ready for playoffs.
I agree. I was going to say, I think it's a little bit of a measuring stick for Bills fans to see where Buffalo stands when they play Kansas City. But I think it's an evenly test matchup between both teams. I think Bills are trying to get healthy right now, so I think that's, you know, if they come out with a loss, I mean, it could be due to injuries. But I think it's a measuring stick type of game to see where they stand, you know, a little less than halfway through the season.
And I think that this is a good test to see. I mean, let's be honest. The Bills brought in Von Miller to get to Patrick Mahomes.
Yep.
That's it.
Right.
That's the reason why they brought him in. So I think it's a good test. I think it's a good test to see where he's at and how much of an impact he is, because again, that was one of the issues last year when you played Kansas City. Patrick Mahomes was standing in that pocket quite comfortably in that playoff game, and that was a big need. And they addressed that with Jordan Phillips, with Von Miller, Shaq Lawson. I mean, they lost Jerry Hughes, but the depth at that D line, they did that for Kansas City. So right. We'll see how that goes.
And if all goes as planned, this is a matchup that they're gonna have again in the playoffs, and I think it kind of gets them ready to see where things will be when they play them again.
Did you guys see that Twitter thing on Mahomes during the Raiders game when he said, "I'm here"?
Oh, yeah. He changed his voice.
Let's see if I can get it on.
I'm here.
It's almost like Kermit the Frog's voice.
I'm here.
I'm here.
I'm here.
I'm here. Yeah, I think it'll be a good game. I think this could be a lot of points. I know you think it's going to be under.
I think it's under.
I think they both score in the 30s. I think this one's going to come down to who has a key turnover late in the game, as it always does. Who turns it over late, or it's going to be who has the ball last. The only thing I'm getting kind of tired of listening to, and again, I think these are
Nick Wright.
No, that too.
He's an idiot.
But these are obviously the two best quarterbacks in the NFL, or top five, however you want to swing it, top five.
They're the best two quarterbacks in the NFL, yes.
I would agree, but the only thing I'm kind of getting tired of listening to is when you see the Mahomes, all the sidearm passes that they keep showing on ESPN, there are so many other quarterbacks that have done that and making some.
Stafford's been throwing no-look passes for years.
I'm just tired of everybody doing this with Pat. And I like Mahomes. I'm not taking anything away from him. I think he's a really good quarterback. I mean, Josh Allen's done the no-look thing. I mean, all these guys do it. Why do they make such a big deal over Mahomes?
Because he's on the best team in football. So you got to hype it up.
Yeah, but I'm just kind of over it.
Look at the NBA.
He's good.
A lot of people shoot threes and shoot deep threes.
Steph Curry.
Steph Curry's the only one that does it, but, you know.
No, that's because he's doing the hallway shots. He's doing the behind-the-basket shots, the warm-ups.
I get it. But, you know what? When you're the best team in the league, and the Chiefs have been the best team in the league.
Oh. I'm here. I'm here.
They were playing that all weekend. I'm here. The ESPN show on Full Ride with Neuheisel and Chris Childers. They were playing that. But, yeah, no, I think you're 100% right. Now, as high school coaches, when you're trying to teach fundamentals and you tell your quarterback or point guard you're not doing all that fancy stuff, that's what you're up against.
Oh, you're telling me. Yeah, we want good shots. No, I'm going to pull up from 40, you know, because that's what they do. Absolutely. I agree with you.
Or you get the guy from, was it the Phillies that hit the home run, slammed his bat down and ran right. So what do you think my son says?
Exactly. I want a bat flip.
He thinks it's okay.
Absolutely.
No,
they've
it's not.
Normalized
run
it.
The bases. Let's see if we got if that Stefan.
It's our Mets fan, our resident Mets fan.
All right. Stefan? We're talking NFL here. Come on.
Oh, you can tell me about Pacini's Braves going down. What's happening?
That's the best I've ever heard. I've never heard him happier.
What's going on?
He's rooting for the Phillies now.
Yeah, of course he is. He didn't watch baseball all season long until the Braves got into the postseason. He came in every day to work with a Braves shirt on. And all of a sudden he was watching baseball again. Stefan, what'd you think first? We're talking football here. What'd you think? Syracuse now moves to 6-0.
The Orange are going bowling officially, and they looked good yesterday. They played well, and I would be happy if they finished like 8-4 or something.
Yeah, we were talking about it here. I could see at 8-4, 9-3. I mean, with the schedule they have left, there's still a lot of winnable games on that schedule. But it's nice to say Syracuse is going bowling. They need that.
Yes, it is.
Stefan, what do you think of the big game in the NFL today? Bills, Chiefs, who you like?
I'm going with the Bills. I'm going with the hometown favorites. And I think the Bills want revenge from last year's playoffs.
Yeah, absolutely. Two of the best quarterbacks in the game for sure. They'll go head-to-head. I think this is going to be that rivalry for a long time with these two young guys. Both impressive.
Yes, it will be.
And, Stefan, the Yankees blow a lead last night in the ninth, and Aaron Boone getting criticized, rightfully so, of how he used the bullpen there late in the game. They're down 2-1 to Cleveland. The wild card teams are putting up some good fights.
Yes, they are. And the Padres upset the Dodgers as well.
Yeah, I didn't see that one coming. But listen, San Diego's been a good team all year in a pretty tough conference. Hey, but the best part is Pacini's Braves are gone, so I can't wait to see him tomorrow. I might go out and buy a Philly shirt. I might have to rub it in and go with the Phillies jersey on tomorrow. We'll have to wait and see. Stefan, what do you think about the Giants and Ravens? Who you like in that game today?
I'm going with the Giants. That's my team. I'm sticking with them, and I hope they go to 5-1.
Yeah, I'm with you. I'm a Giants fan, too. I said they might be the worst 4-1 team in the game, but the best thing about it, Stefan, they're 4-1. You can't take it away from them.
No.
So, well, listen, my man, we appreciate the call. Stay healthy, be good, and we'll talk to you again next week.
Okay, thanks, Cole.
You got it. So, Stefan, going with the two New York teams.
Yeah. Hey, I don't want to Man, I don't want to say anything or brag, but when you guys weren't here and Coach Howard came in and we ran the show together, I called Padres, Phillies, Houston, and Yankees were the final four.
You did, because I called in. Did you? Too.
Yeah.
Who am I have to start calling you? Nick Gammons?
Nick Gammons. No, I'm just saying. You know,
this is Peter Gammons for ESPN.
Scottsdale, Arizona, and Diamondbacks training camp.
Could be Tim Kirchen.
Tim Kirchen. I like Tim. Yeah, Timmy Kirchen.
All right. All right, that's enough baseball talk, though. Let's go back.
So here's some of the other games.
Let's celebrate the orange.
Other games today. And let me know if there's one of these games that stands out to you. 49s, Atlanta, no. 49ers, 49s. That game, no. Patriots and Browns, no.
Yes, that's going to be a good game, guys. I hate to say it. One of those teams could fall to, what, 2-4?
When did you ever think we'd say this? The 3-2 Jets at the 3-2 Packers today.
I think the Jets.
The Colts, I can't figure them out at all. They beat Kansas City, and then they laid egg another week.
Yeah.
They'll play the Jags. Vikings at 4-1. The Dolphins, Tua's back next week.
Potentially next week.
Potentially.
Tyler Thompson is not going to be quick.
The Bengals and Saints, don't really care about that one. The 3-2 Ravens against the 4-1 Giants today at 1:00.
I
think that'll be a good game.
Well, let's understand that this could be the 5-0 Ravens against the 4-1 Giants, or the 1-4 Giants easily. You know, if games were flipped. Yep.
The Tampa Bay Bucks at the 1-4 Steelers. I don't think that one's going to be.
That's a blowout.
The 1-4 Panthers at the 2-3 Rams.
Oh, yeah. Well, let me sign off for that one.
We'll see how long McCaffrey stays a Panther. The big news with Carolina.
The 2-3 Cardinals at the 2-3 Seahawks.
That's a good game.
Another great game, huh?
That's a great game.
And then the nightcap tonight, the 4-1 Cowboys against the 5-0 Eagles.
That's going to be a big game. That's
the overrated bowl.
So the question for you guys is the question that's come up a lot. And I still think because of the money they're paying Dak Prescott, he's your quarterback when he's ready to play. Cooper Rush hasn't lost a game as a starting quarterback.
Cooper Rush is your quarterback going forward.
Disagree.
Until he loses.
I wouldn't disagree with you.
You do not go back.
But
listen,
you can't sit the guy that's making all the money.
You might have to. If he wins this game and he's 5-0, and again, Dak is rushing back because he feels his job is threatened right now.
No.
If they were 2-3, 1-4.
I don't disagree with
I think right. Dak takes his
game,
time
knowing
that he has all the power. You know, he's he's not there. But they're winning without him. Dak is trying to get back as quick as possible. If they win this game, if they beat the last undefeated team in the NFL, Cooper Rush is the quarterback until they lose.
I don't think so.
I don't think so either.
I just think you're paying him too much money.
I don't think so either.
Or
I agree.
Do you put a package together to trade one of them?
I don't think anybody. I mean, I think there's teams that could use a quarterback, Giants. I don't know that anyone's going to trade.
No one's going to put a package together for Cooper Rush. Come on.
I just think with all the money they have invested in Dak Prescott.
Yeah, I think he's.
You can't sit him.
I mean, you could easily say, hey, we're not trying to rush him. He's not ready yet.
Right.
Hope
I think
he's
that's
still
what
not
you
ready.
Do. I think you
Hope
stall
he's
him.
Still,
right.
He's still not ready. And you go with Cooper until all of a sudden, you know, they lose a game and then, reports in. Dak Prescott cleared to play now.
Right.
Well, I think they got it set up pretty good because I think if you're a Cowboys fan and you would have thought that you guys would be 4-1 without Dak Prescott, you would take that. Because I remember when he went down there saying,
if they can just go
500 and get Dak back, and now you're 4-1 with a chance to go 5-1 and tied for first place.
I agree. You want to ride the hot hand right now. But I think if Dak is ready, it's hard not to go back to him. But I agree, Nick, with you. It's like, push them off if you can and say.
When's their bye week? Because I think that would be a lot too. If they have a bye week coming up, you get to the bye week and then it gives Dak a week of practice before he comes back and takes over.
Listen, you know who I feel sorry for? I feel sorry for Al Michaels and Kirk Herbstreit.
Oh man.
To sit through the Thursday night games on Amazon.
Those games are awful.
The Amazon should give everybody their money back.
Yeah.
Because those games have been absolutely horrible.
I think someone should give Amazon their money back.
That's true.
Putting these damn games on, giving these games to them to put on the air. I mean, holy cow.
And if you listen to Al Michaels, he pretty much comes right out and says these are horrible.
Yes.
On the air.
Yes.
You know, he's come right out
what
and made some comments.
To say? Holy
I mean,
cow.
The Commanders won 12-7.
Yeah.
Listen, the Commanders shouldn't be on TV, period.
Yeah.
Well, I don't disagree with that, and the Bears are even worse.
Yeah, I was going to say, the Bears are even
Justin
worse.
Justin Fields is horrible.
Yeah. That,
horrible.
Wait, Justin Fields is horrible. Isn't he supposed to be the next franchise quarterback for the Bears?
Yeah.
What happened to that conversation?
But again, you can be a good college quarterback. It doesn't mean you're going to be an NFL quarterback.
But he came out and played well that first game, and all of a sudden
I don't know that he's played well all year.
Yeah,
I don't know.
They knighted him. They knighted him as the next... The Michael Jordan of the Bears all of a sudden.
Well, think about this, the Ohio State quarterbacks in the NFL.
Yeah.
Not many of them.
Dwayne Haskins.
Yeah. No. Cardale Jones. Braxton Miller. Sure.
None of them have really panned out. And again,
Terrell
it goes
Pryor
back to.
Didn't even play quarterback. He played wide receiver.
Yeah. Yeah. Goes back to you're a system-oriented quarterback in college.
Well, what was it, Jeff Tedford? Remember the Jeff Tedford system quarterback?
Yep. Mm-hmm. Yep.
What amazes me though, like I just don't understand this. There's so many guys whose their jobs is to analyze quarterbacks and make these draft picks. How many NFL quarterbacks have gotten picked and never made it in the NFL? Like, are you that bad at your job?
But I'm gonna stop you there for 1 second because a lot of it comes down to the GM and the team they get drafted on as well. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you take Baker Mayfield and he ended up on the Ravens, you'd be talking about him with all that defense not having to do a ton. If you put Lamar on the Jets,
I think there's a lot of good quarterbacks that have fallen because of the team they played on.
Yes.
The Jets.
And a lot of it, I think, also has to do with that they draft on potential a lot of the times.
Yep. 'Cause
they think if they can get him in their system, they can do all the right things to make this guy be what we think he's gonna be. And then just their situation doesn't turn out.
But they're wrong so many times on these quarterbacks. It's like your job is to be this guru to pick talent. I can do the same thing. I can sit here all day long and pick all these quarterbacks that I think might be good in the NFL.
First of all, Ron Rivera didn't want Carson Wentz at quarterback. The GM wanted him.
That was clear.
So, you know, you get these quarterbacks. I mean, I don't know. Throw Justin Fields on a good team. Throw him in Buffalo. Is he having the same amount of success in Buffalo? Is he better in Buffalo?
Oh, he's better in Buffalo. Yeah. You know? Absolutely.
I mean, the Bears have the worst offensive line in the NFL.
Yeah.
But I think that's the knock on a lot of these quarterbacks.
And that's the thing. When you get drafted high, you got to remember that you're going to the worst team.
Yeah. Right.
I mean, Trevor Lawrence, everybody keeps saying Trevor Lawrence is a bust. Trevor Lawrence played on a team that was horrendous.
Yeah.
And then their first round pick, Travis Etienne, is out for the year. Like, again, you're not going to a good situation. Josh Allen looked horrendous his first year.
Yeah.
They called him a bust.
Oh, so did Peyton Manning.
Yeah, they struggle early on. It's about being in the right situation with the right GM that can build around you. That's why, again, I'll talk Giants for a second. You know, people are comparing Daniel Jones and Josh Allen, but they're playing two completely different games. Josh Allen got Stephon Diggs. They drafted Gabe Davis. They got Isaiah McKenzie. They got weapons around him. They drafted Singletary. If the Giants can do the same thing, and I'm not saying Daniel Jones is the answer. I look at him as like what Tyrod was with the Bills. He's kind of a journeyman that's going to kind of keep you afloat until you bring in that franchise quarterback. But you need to get weapons first, a line first, and then get your quarterback.
I agree. I think too many teams do it backwards. I mean, you don't get this Mona Lisa and then go hang it in the freaking, you know,
in a bar
shack.
But it's also getting the right people around them and the right mentors and building the right culture.
Well, I think you see the prime example with Coach Dable in New York. I mean, from him, you saw what he did with the Bills. He goes over to the Giants and the culture's changed all of a sudden. It's different.
Well, I think it goes back a lot of it to is college. When I say this all the time is, how can Notre Dame not find a quarterback? All these colleges that get all these good recruiting classes, and I'll say Jim Harbaugh, how do you not
develop?
We said
the same thing about Michigan
for a quarterback for all these years.
Yep.
I think it's the same thing in the NFL. I think you're taking a shot on a lot of these guys that Justin Fields looked really good in college. Really good. And I think his combine, I think he had the arm strength. I think he tested, yep, you know, very well. So he was a high draft pick. But I think it's no different than colleges. You're only as good as what you put around you. And if you don't, if you don't have an offensive line, you're screwed. And I think it's been similar to Daniel Jones, yep, in New York. I think it was the same with Eli Manning. Eli Manning took a pounding in New York, and they wanted to run Eli out of there and insert Daniel Jones, who has looked better under Brian Daboll, but I still, right, don't think he's the guy going forward. But, right, you can't knock him because he's had a better start to the season. Again, I said they're the worst 4-1 team in the league, but the best thing about it is they're 4-1, yeah, and there's a lot of NFL teams that would like to be 4-1.
Well, certainly.
Speaking of quarterback, oh, sorry, go ahead.
I was going to say, look at Russell Wilson. Yeah. Wasn't a first-round pick. Goes to Seattle. They surround him with the right people. Got a coach that has a good culture.
Great,
and
he's
playing great. He looks like a Pro Bowler every year. Denver,
yep,
comes in with a rookie
worst
coach.
Offense in
and
the
he,
league.
And he, yes, looks, he doesn't even look like the same person.
No.
And it's all about what's around him, the culture, the coaching, how they set him up. Do they roll him out? Do they keep him in the pocket? Like, there's more to it than this guy is good, this guy isn't.
And it's a shame because they have one of the best defenses,
yes,
in the league, but they have one of the worst offenses in the league. Let's ride.
That's right.
That's God, that's so brutal.
I can't see
it. Here's one more quarterback thing. I don't know if you heard this latest news coming out of, I don't know where it is, but Deshaun Watson.
Yeah, another
26th allegation has come out.
Yeah. Wow.
He paid somebody, yep, $300 for a $150, yep, massage.
Yep, I heard that.
With stipulations.
Well, what week is he expected back?
He's out 12 games, so 13. Or 11 games, and he's got a bye.
If there's more allegations that are going to start coming out against this guy, is it time to just cut ties with him?
No. You just paid him $250 million guaranteed because they thought they did their research and he was kind of moving. They were moving forward.
Yeah, but if more allegations come out, isn't that contract going to be void? Can you void that contract and say, listen, we're parting ways?
If they put it in the contract, yes.
He's back week 13, yes, and he's your starting quarterback week 13. And right now, Cleveland, I know it's early.
What does that say for the NFL?
I don't disagree.
About, you know, we care about women, we care about domestic violence, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah, but the NFL has screwed up everything so far this year.
I agree.
Calvin Ridley's out a year for gambling on football games. Yep. Deshaun Watson comes back after his 26th
what is that show
allegation.
Yeah. Right.
Tua cleared for protocol, having a seizure on the, like, you know, wobble
and damn
around.
It, Cincinnati's putting in gambling, booking at the stadium,
at the
and Pete
stadium.
Rose is banned from the damn Hall of Fame.
Let's put a team in Vegas.
Come on.
Get a team in Vegas. Oh, wait, we did.
Unbelievable. I heard that, and I'm telling you, I was like, wait a minute. The Reds are putting a sports book at the stadium that's going to be open 24/7 every day, 7 days a week.
In the stadium where your baseball players play.
If I was the owner, I'd say, Pete Rose, I want you to be our first customer.
There you go.
I'd make him the director of sports book.
Absolutely.
There you go.
We'll call it the Hall of Fame Sports Betting.
What is this world coming to? What is this world coming to? But anyways. All right, it's going to be on you guys the next 2 weeks if you guys are free. I'm gone for work next Friday and Saturday night, the weekend after.
I'll be gone Sunday for a hockey tournament.
I'll be at Penn State, Ohio State in 2 weeks. So if you guys are good to do the show, it's yours. If not, I'm out the next 2 weeks, so you guys will have to let me know who's available, who's not, if you can do it 1 week and not the other. But we'll make it work. Enjoy today. Nice fall day outside. Some big games today, the NFL. If you're a Syracuse fan, celebrate 6-0 with a big one next week to see if they can look and upset Clemson at Clemson to move to 7-0. So lots to look forward to in college football, the NFL, and much more. And it's hard to believe to say in 1 month we'll be talking some college basketball.
And I was going to say, if you haven't heard enough of me, come hear me at the Pop Warner game today.
Yep, Pags is on the PA for what, the Westmoreland Pop Warner game today?
Read the names first before you say them.
Yes, yes.
I did last week. I don't know if I have time to tell you real quick. So last week, the team we were playing against had their names backwards. They had last name first, so I had to, you know, look at the first name and say it. When I got to the first kid on the Westmoreland team, I read it last name backwards. Yeah, it was great.
Spoken like a true Hall of Famer. All right, enjoy the weekend, everybody. We're out.
Can you remember the last time you tried something out without searching for it online first? Me either. Yet, over half of all small businesses don't even have a website. Why is that? It's so easy. Theyare2Design will work with your business to create an affordable, customizable, and easy-to-use website that appears in today's top search engines. That way, consumers can find you. Don't lie.
Talk Radio, 1450 AM, 103.3 FM, WKAL, Rome, Utica, Syracuse, New York.
Time now.